Penguin Random House Canada presents The Wolfpack, the Millennial Mobsters Who Brought Chaos and the Cartels to the Canadian Underworld, by Peter Edwards and Luis Nájera. Read for you by Juan Chioran and Luis Nájera.
Forward. 1. Hello, my name is Luis Horacio Nájera. I'm the author. My relationship with Juan Carlos began through his attraction to my close friend. As the new kid in our town, he approached me looking for a wingman to set them up. Eventually, I agreed and began organizing quick trips after class or during recess to a Mexican fast food place near our high school. I invited Juan Carlos to join us under the pretext of helping him get to know his new peers. Despite his efforts, his romantic endeavors with my friend failed. I asked her why she had rejected him. She replied, in a somber tone, "There's something in his eyes that doesn't seem right." Juan Carlos was a quiet, discreet, slim guy with a big mustache and cowboy boots who enrolled in our school just to complete his final year. He had moved from Guadalajara to our smaller town, nearly 600 kilometers away. Guadalajara was then, in the late 80s, home to the notorious group led by Mexico's original padrino, Godfather, Miguel Ángel Félix Gallardo. In his 70s today, Gallardo is a historic figure in the world of global drug trafficking. He transformed transnational organized crime by assigning territories across the country to distinct cocaine trafficking groups, later self-identified as the Gulf, Juarez, Tijuana, and Sinaloa cartels. Protected by corrupt authorities, Gallardo's own Guadalajara cartel operated as an umbrella for smaller groups that worked mostly within the Golden Triangle, a mountainous area located between the states of Durango, Sinaloa, and Chihuahua, towards the country's northwest. Because of its altitude, weather, and access to the U.S. border and the Pacific Ocean, the region is ideal for harvesting marijuana and heroin, and then smuggling it north into the world's largest illicit drug market. One of the organizations doing this work, and doing it under the protection of the Guadalajara cartel, was led by the father of my new classmate. As the school year continued, Juan Carlos revealed more about himself. He was the first person I had ever met with a connection to the drug trade. That said, he never offered me, or any other students, marijuana joints, heroin balls, or carefully folded packages of cocaine. As I look back to 1988, it was clear Juan Carlos had learned to be careful. He was being groomed to inherit his father's place as the leader of a drug trafficking organization. One day that spring, classes had finished early, and Juan Carlos surprised some friends and me with an invitation to spend the day at his family place in the suburbs. The place was a farm with a spacious two-bedroom house, a separate bungalow, and a barn located in a semi-rural area outside of the city. The property was well known in the community because it was enclosed by walls as tall as any other house in the area and was often visited by small groups of brand new pickup trucks with tinted windows. Word on the street was that the house was owned by someone influential, either a politician or a drug lord, who enjoyed throwing parties that frequently extended for days and included beautiful women and famous musicians, all hired to perform. Minutes after we arrived at the property, our host left in his white Ford pickup. About 30 minutes later, he returned with beer, ice, and chips, and lots of them. That was the first of many parties, all-inclusive ones, that Juan Carlos threw for his classmates, and they quickly turned him into the most popular guy in school. He seemed to enjoy his new status, despite the quiet, calm personality that he maintained even after drinking a few beers. I don't even remember ever seeing him drunk, even as the parties raged around him. Perhaps because our relationship had begun before his surge in popularity, and because my family made sure I wasn't a partier like most of our classmates, my friendship with Juan Carlos matured in trust. That gave me a chance to know who he really was and to confirm what my friend had meant when she said something about his eyes didn't seem right. "Do you like guns?" Juan Carlos asked me one day as we were driving across town in his pickup. "Yes, I do like guns. Who doesn't?" I replied. My attitude was typical teenager, macho, stupid, deeply influenced by the culture of weapons that still exist in northern Mexico. He smiled as he continued driving, pulled a Colt 38 Super pistol out from under his seat. It was an automatic gun popular among drug traffickers, particularly among those working up in the mountains, because of its reliability, heft, and firepower. "Have you seen one of these?" he asked, handing it to me. I grew up in a small town where men carried guns, so seeing a pistol was not unusual, but handling a loaded one without adult supervision was a new experience, as exciting as it was imprudent. After holding the gun for a few minutes, and once the initial excitement passed, the future journalist in me came out. "Why do you need to carry a gun?" I asked. Juan Carlos smiled. "You never know when it may be helpful to have it with you." As the end of the term approached, my admiration for Juan Carlos was diluted by the excitement of plans to move to a new city to begin my undergrad studies in communications. One day after school, during the final weeks of classes, Juan Carlos and I talked about our futures. He told me he will move back to Guadalajara to study business administration at a private university. Again, my incipient reporter rose up and I asked, "Why do you want to study that?" I guess I judged the book by its cover because, in my view, Juan Carlos didn't fit the mold of an entrepreneur, store manager, or businessman, particularly when driving a pickup with a loaded gun. He looked at me and smiled. And bam, a glimpse of the person taking shape behind the mustache appeared. "My family thinks I need to go back to school and learn business administration. They think it will be best for us and for nuestro negocio, our business," he said as his facial expression hardened. Right in front of me, he transformed from a quiet high school student into a cold-hearted adult. I required no additional explanations to understand the nature of the business and the source of the money, the house in the suburbs, the need for a gun, and the secrecy Juan Carlos always kept about his family and himself. His future plans involved becoming part of the new generation of drug kingpins. More educated, not addicted to drugs, tech-savvy, and with a less flamboyant lifestyle than their predecessors. An awkward silence, then an unexpected invitation. "Would you like to work for us?" 2. On a sunny, hot day in May 2007, I was driving throughout a remote, mountainous area of Sonora in Mexico's northwest. 8 hours earlier, 50 members of Los Zetas cartel had left a bloody trail along the road I was traveling. Overnight, they had kidnapped and killed 5 municipal police officers and 3 civilians from 3 different towns. When the government detected the operation, hundreds of soldiers and police officers gave chase. The manhunt only increased the bloodshed. 14 of the alleged criminals were killed during the pursuit across the mountains. Accompanying me was Miguel Cervantes, an experienced photographer based in Tijuana. We had been assigned by the newspaper Reforma to report on the incident. Along the road, evidence of the night's violence was easy to detect. Outside the small town of Arispe, where the police had intercepted the hitmen, thousands of empty bullet shells littered the streets. Broken windows and perforated facades pointed us up to a dusty road, where the fighting had continued. A brutal display of Mexico's war on drugs unfolded as we moved into the mountains. After a few minutes of driving, I was struck by how the natural beauty of the landscape contrasted with signs of the battle fought hours before.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.